Have you ever wondered what's the deal with these so-called gaming products? If you make the tremendous effort of leaving the gaming socks and gaming condoms memes aside, there has to be a solid reason for why this gaming etiquette gives birth to so many jokes. Nowadays, every goddamn thing has the term gaming in its name, maybe simply because companies themselves abuse this terminology. You won't find anything that hasn't already got a specific gaming spin-off or a gaming lineup, be it gaming phones, gaming accessories, and of course, gaming laptops and gaming PCs. Don't you find that annoying? So, let's talk about what actually makes a thing to be a gaming thing. Maybe shining colors and an RGB overdose, maybe an atypical design. So, what's the first thing we need to make sure of when discussing a gaming desktop or a gaming laptop? Well, being able to run games, right? But that might be a bit ambiguous. It's a difference between a system being able to start a game and being able to actually run it smoothly. To be more specific, just because a cheap wooden system has gaming in its name, it doesn't mean it is actually a gaming system. Therefore, the first and most important characteristic is indeed performance. It doesn't matter what says on the product, it doesn't matter how it looks, all that matters is performance. And performance is achieved through powerful components, especially the backbone, like CPU and GPU, but it also has to rely on potent and often neglected parts, such as memory, storage, and PSU. Moreover, the rig, be it desktop or laptop, has to incorporate a good cooling solution, and so on. Is the looks of the thing important as well? Certainly, but to a lesser extent than the actual performance. Finally, before ending this introduction, I have to make a disclaimer. I admit I am not a fan of these so-called gaming products. A lot of them seem to be much too attention-seeking and overrated, and most of them lack originality. And by speaking like this, I assume I will get cancelled. Well, sorry, but not sorry. My problem with these so-called gaming products, and by extension, the reason these things have become some sort of a joke, is quite easy to pinpoint. Many such products are just looks, intended to make them feel like a genuine gaming product. And because of that, we end up with another question. If some sort of product respects the aforementioned performance requirements, yet fails to conform to the image and the expectations people have regarding this gaming category, can that product still be considered a genuine gaming device? What do you think? Feel free to pause this video and think about that. When you're done, resume this video, because what I'm about to show you is pure confusion spelled in all caps. With all due respect, what the fuck did Asus think of when they decided to launch this? To begin with, this thing is called ROG Flow X16. Honestly, I can't really tell if this is a gaming laptop, although formally speaking, it kinda is, because, you know, the name stands for Republic of Gamers. But that doesn't necessarily mean that this laptop is magically turned into a gaming laptop. Even more so, because by the looks of it, Flow X16 is not even a traditional laptop. In fact, this thing right here is a 2-in-1 device. However, this is the most powerful 2-in-1 we ever tested. So, if performance is still the most important criteria in this argument, then X16 could be considered a gaming laptop, despite its hybrid characteristics. Somehow, I keep thinking whether we've been programmed to think in ones and zeros, gaming and non-gaming, and if so, maybe this is what makes us obtuse. In the end, does the name and label really matter? Because if we skip the labeling, we are presented with a generous 2-in-1 solution. The previous iteration, Flow X13, came as a pleasant surprise for us. A 13-inch tablet actually made some sense. But for this 16-inch variant to become popular, it's gonna be a lot harder. Flow X13 had everything designed with ergonomics in mind: lightweight, comfortable dimensions, and an acceptable screen-to-body ratio. Unfortunately, I don't think things will be the same for this 16-inch model. What was the actual reason when Asus came up with this monster? Something like, I don't know, Godzilla meets Flow X13? In a way, X16 is powerful enough to shame any basic gaming laptop, but strength is not the only thing that matters in this context. Want to use X16 as a standard laptop? Go for it. Want to switch to tent mode to binge watch some shows? Go for it. Do you want to surf the internet via tablet mode and doodle using a stylus? X16 got you covered. And yes, indeed, the screen can turn full 360 degrees. What is more, using it in tent mode ensures a more efficient cooling process. The hinges are pretty tough, something typical for 2-in-1 devices, but they appear to be slightly squeaking, or at least that's what's happening to our review sample. The 2 kg, 2 cm thick chassis is not great, not terrible, but if we go on and take a look at what's hiding under the hood, I must tell you the chassis is still slim and lightweight. The build quality is cool, the texture on the lead and on the wrist pad does not gather fingerprints that quickly. I enjoy the keyboard as well. The keycaps have a nice feedback and pretty long keystroke of around 1.7 mm. RGB is nice, even though it does not highlight the keys themselves, but rather the area surrounding them. And last but not least, I appreciated the exotic touchpad. This one is made of glass, has a really smooth slide rate, almost without any resistance, and almost tempting you into giving up your mouse. As for the display, well, this is a mini LED that looks fantastic, not only in games. X16 has an IPS 16x10 display, meaning the vertical resolution is a bit more generous. The final result is a 2560x1600 resolution with a maximum refresh rate of 165Hz. In short, that's a lot. It's a far cry from the traditional Full HD gaming display, so you might easily label it as a true 2022 gaming display. Even more interesting than these values is a rather uncommon, if not unique, implementation. This display has a dual way of operating. It's about the multi-zone mode and the one-zone mode, in which the 512 fault zones are deactivated, resulting in more uniform colors and brightness. What do the measurements of the screen tell us? The multi-zone mode is more lively and more spectacular. Games look more vibrant, black is really black, the contrast is at its peak, but with a cost. Multi-zone sacrifices how uniform brightness is across some areas and how accurately the colors are displayed. If you take a look at the screenshots, we have 4 different brightness levels when mini LED mode is active. The first test shows how the display's peak brightness is too much for our measuring device. That's the reason why the poor SpiderX Elite failed to detect any uniformity difference, not because it does not exist, but because the Spider fails to detect anything past the 955 nits threshold. It should be noticed, however, that the lower brightness, the more prominent the differences between areas increase. This increase goes way past the limit we usually consider acceptable, meaning it exceeds the 15% value. This does not apply when one zone is engaged. Differences between brightness levels go below the average value recorded by the modern high-quality panels. This is a huge difference between the contrast levels of each of the two modes. Mini LED has the blackest black of them all, right at 0.12 nits, while the overall brightness is set at 673, meaning a contrast ratio of 5810:1. On the other hand, one zone has a meh to decent 920:1 contrast ratio. Although both modes show a similar color space, meaning 100% sRGB, 92% Adobe RGB and 100% DCI-P3, one zone wins by an average value under 1 when it comes to delta E for color accuracy. Okay, cool. But what does that mean in English? It means you should switch to multi-zone mode when playing games or watching movies and choose one zone if you plan on editing images and videos. Okay, leaving the display aside, it's time to talk about connectivity before moving to the most important part, performance itself. In short, Flow X16 features a pretty good connectivity. Everything seems to be in place, maybe even better than I originally expected. Let's start with the fancier things like the USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type-C port, which doubles for a DisplayPort, or a DC port and, most impressive, G-Sync, NVIDIA G-Sync. In addition, there's another USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type-C port, which also supports DisplayPort and power delivery. When it comes to the traditional devices like mice, USB sticks and so on, the laptop offers 2 traditional USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type-A ports, accompanied by the faithful HDMI 2.0b and 3.5 mm combo audio jack. But the package is completed with this unique port designed for transferring huge amounts of data as fast as possible, called ROG XG Mobile Interface. Did someone say external GPU? Yes, because Flow X16 got that too. Yep, this brick is called XG Station, and if you buy it as well, you not only get some more connectivity options, but you can also charge your laptop directly via XG Station. And now it's time to move on to the moment of truth: performance, cooling, temperatures, and noise levels. Spoiler warning, the AMD processor included in this system is absolutely fantastic. The high-end X16 configuration integrates a Ryzen 9 6900HS and an NVIDIA GeForce RTX 3070 Ti GPU. But for now, let's talk about the CPU, and mind you, not hurry to conclusions because the specified 45W TDP might be solely for informative purpose. The devil lies in the details, in this case in benchmarking tests like Cinebench. In reality, the scores achieved by this Ryzen 9 6900HS were not meant for your average 45W CPU. As shown in the charts, this Ryzen 9 starts at 78W but gradually lowers its TDP to an average of 66-67W for the remaining benchmarks, reaching a stable point afterwards. It manages to avoid overheating and it does keep the chassis pretty cool, pun intended, but what truly matters is the fact that the CPU never ever went into throttle. Well, yeah, benchmarks like Cinebench force it into some 95 degrees Celsius, but for the gaming part, the temperatures never exceeded 85. Even more, if we switch off the discrete 3070 Ti GPU, the main culprit in terms of heat generation, and use the external GPU, the CPU temperatures get even lower. An interesting example would be Metro Exodus, where the temperature dropped from 84 degrees Celsius to an impressive 65. A major, close to 25 degrees Celsius difference, and that says a lot. And speak of the devil, let's see what's the deal with this interesting external graphics card. I initially wondered why should Asus bother sending us the external GPU alongside this laptop that already integrates the excellent 125W RTX 3070 Ti. Later on, I understood why. It's not about the significant performance boost, although it does not really justify the need of buying the separate eGPU. In all due fairness, it's about getting rid of the heat. On one side, you can see the temperatures recorded when using the 3070 Ti GPU. On the other one, you can see the temperatures recorded when we switch to the eGPU. So the eGPU helps keeping the entire laptop cool, ergo better performance. The testing session started by running Blender. During the short rendering session, the discrete 3070 Ti brought around 48.5 degrees Celsius on the keyboard area and around 40 degrees Celsius above the keyboard. When switching the GPU to the external RTX 3080 and repeating the test, the final temperatures decreased by around 10 degrees. And that's only the beginning. After 30 minutes of benchmarking the laptop in Metro Exodus on the highest RTX preset, XG Mobile with this GeForce 3080 lowers the temperature of the chassis by 15 degrees Celsius compared to the integrated GPU. The difference is huge, but how's that possible? Well, it goes like this. The 3070 Ti has a TDP of 125W, reaches up to 86 degrees Celsius, and all the heat dissipation goes straight into the chassis. On the other hand, the eGPU, although having a bigger TDP of 150W and reaching 84 degrees Celsius, keeps the heat away from the laptop thanks to the 38cm long power cable. Basically, if you're playing a game that's not that much of a stress for the CPU, you could say the laptop itself is almost inactive, cold as steel. The performance boost brought by the eGPU is somewhere between 10% and 25% depending on which game you're running. Hence what I said earlier, the biggest edge is not necessarily sheer power, but rather the fact that the Flow X16 literally keeps a cool profile. Despite these advantages, I'm not sure there would be plenty of people eager to taste this upgrade from an integrated RTX 3070 Ti to the RTX 3080 brought by the XG Mobile, because it's painfully expensive. In addition, let's not forget that Flow X16 comes into three different configurations, starting from RTX 3050 Ti, then RTX 3060, and then this RTX 3070 Ti model. In this context, the eGPU would be much more relevant for the lower-end variations, namely 3050 Ti and 3060. Moving forward, X16 does have some aspects which need to be improved upon, such as battery life. The default software failed to impress us, especially if we take into account the huge 90Wh battery. The initial results were no more than just average, so something's gotta be wrong. The Armory Crate software kept the laptop running on silent mode while the maximum battery mode was turned on and the RGB lighting off and the display dimmed to 177 nits brightness. On top of that, the GPU was set on hybrid mode, in which the 3070 Ti should have gone low. Nevertheless, the results were shady as hell. Everything seemed like the end of this review until an update for Armory Crate popped up. And boy, now that's the change I'm talking about. Suddenly, I could play with more power management modes for the GPU. So, I started the battery tests all over again. And it paid off, since I got some extra 103 minutes of autonomy, which means 31% more battery juice. That's more like it. Remember, during this time, the screen was operating on the panel power saver mode, going from 165 Hz to 60. Well, at least Asus did something useful and introduced an auto switch that deactivates the high refresh rate when the laptop is not plugged in. What is more, 177 nits in brightness is indeed noticeably more than the 130-150 nits we used to call a standard last year. Overall, Flow X16 met my expectations and even exceeded them in some aspects. Excellent performance, a big battery of 90 watt-hour, decent temperatures and noise levels, considering how thin the chassis is, alongside a display that's perfect for gaming and movies. To be honest, I fancied this display more than any OLED on any laptop, but that's somehow a matter of taste. In addition, the most important aspect of this laptop it is its versatility. X16 outshines most of the gaming laptops as soon as you attach an ROG XG mobile to it. More specifically, it's not just about the extra performance, but it's also about low temperatures in gaming sessions. All things considered, this model is already destroying frames, but wait until you hook it to this eGPU. So, we've reached that part in the video where I want to hear your thoughts on this ROG Flow X16. To be or not to be a genuine gaming laptop? This is the question. I'd say this is indeed a gaming laptop, although there are still some little things that might be seen as drawbacks, not necessarily in terms of build, but rather in terms of reasoning, for I find it a bit confusing. I, for one, wouldn't have designed this laptop to be a two-in-one model, for a more classical approach would have been the sweetest spot. What do you think about that? Personally, I would have chosen a simple display turning at 180 degrees or even less. That would have been more than enough, and designing it as a simple gaming laptop would have cut both costs and weight. In addition, I don't really need a touchscreen. Most of the time, you'll just make the display dirty and smudgy without bringing any extra versatility. Do you really think that's actually necessary for a gaming laptop? Ditching this 2-in-1 and touchscreen stuff would have eliminated the need for such a thick and ultra-resistant glass that adds to the laptop weight. I mean, around 2 kilograms is still kinda heavy. This makes the laptop a bit uncomfortable to transport, which again, would have been already solved hadn't been for that thick protective glass touchscreen and 360 degrees lid. Not to mention that the laptop would have ended up being cheaper. Anyways, it's a matter of personal preference, and I did nothing more than stating my own opinion, which might or might not be shared by other people. Which makes me curious about your take on this subject. What do you think of ROG Flow X16? It's an interesting piece of technology, for sure, and I had fun dissecting it for you. If you want to see more in-depth reviews, why not subscribe to our channel? More tech quality stuff is on the way, so stay tuned and thank you.